Thank you so much for inviting me here and giving the opportunity to give this talk. So I will be discussing today the work which we did essentially with my team when I worked in the US. We started essentially this work with Bob Stellenwerf and Miloš Stanić when I've been at the University of Chicago. Then we continued with Aklan Bowman, Zachary Dell, Arun Pandian, Nora Schwischer at the Carnegie Mellon University. And I will be essentially presenting this work, the cumulative contribution of our group. We are discussing scale coupling in strong shock-driven Richtmeier-Mishkov flows, and this work has been published partially. Some of the results are also in preparation, and the work was supported by the U.S. National Science Foundation and also by the U.S. Department of Energy. So Richtmeier-Mishkov instability controls many processes in nature and technology in high energy density regimes as well as low energy density regimes. And high energy density regimes, these are supernova and fusion, scramjets and combustors, as well as impact dynamics of liquids and soils. In these environments, the flow dynamics is often characterized by strong shocks, constant densities, large disturbances, and which essentially means that the flow fields change sharply and rapidly on the one hand side. On the other hand side, there is a very small contribution of dissipation and diffusion. As a result, this dynamics is characterized by appearance of interfaces and extensive interfacial Richtmeier-Mishkov mixing. And even though the title of our conference turbulent mixing, in fact, the more we study these problems, the more myself I'm coming to a conclusion that we should talk primarily about interfacial mixing rather than turbulent mixing. So what we did in this work, we conducted the systematic study of Richtmeier-Mishkov instability induced by strong shocks. It means that we considered Mach numbers up to 10. We applied theoretical analysis, which included zero order theory developed by Richtmeier, linear theory developed by Richtmeier, Nishihara, and Wojcik, as well as group theory analysis to study highly nonlinear regimes and order and disorder in Richtmeier-Mishkov flows, as well as we developed a novel empirical model to describe the numerical simulation data. We also applied smooth particle hydrodynamic simulations, which was implemented in the SPHC code, which was developed by Bob Stellenberg for many years. So what we have found that in strong-driven Richtmeier-Mishkov instabilities, initial conditions are the key factors of RMI evolution. That important thing that they exist, we kind of identified a characteristic amplitude scale that enables maximum initial growth rate of Richtmeier-Mishkov instability. We also found that order and disorder in Richtmeier-Mishkov flows is defined to a large extent by the interference of the initial perturbation waves. We also found that there is a coupling, essentially strong coupling of the interfacial and bulk dynamics. Specifically, significant amount of shock energy goes into the material compression and background motion. Only small portion of shock energy is available for interfacial mixing. At the same time, the small scale dynamics is non-uniform and heterogeneous, both at the interface, which is essentially a known fact, as well as in the bulk, which was not so known before. So I will describe briefly what is the Richtmeier-Mishkov instability and Richtmeier-Mishkov mixing is, what is the phenomenon application, outline of the dynamics, and as well as the challenging of modeling and quantification, why this problem is essentially so challenging to study. Richtmeier-Mishkov instability was discovered theoretically by Richtmeier and experimentally by Evgeny Meshkov. It occurs whenever a shock wave refracts an interface between fluids with different values of the acoustic impedance. Shock can be planar or perturbed. It can be steady or unsteady. Shock may propagate from the light fluid to heavy fluid and vice versa. The interface can be planar and perturbed, meaning that essentially RMI may develop when the shock is perturbed and interface is planar, or when the shock is planar and interface is perturbed. RMI plays an important role in a broad range of processes in nature and technology at various scales, from supernova, where the characteristic scales are gigameters, up to the inertial confinement fusion, where the characteristic scales are microns. The post-shock dynamics of Richtmeier-Mishkov instability, essentially after the shock passes the interface, is a superposition of essentially two motions. One motion is such that the fluids and the interface between the fluids move as a whole unit on the one hand side. And on the other hand side, there is an interface perturbation that starts to grow because of impulsive acceleration induced by the shock. If we will be looking at this interfacial dynamics, which is actually well illustrated by this figure by Katie Presrich in gas dynamic experiments, we see that there are the large scale, essentially coherent structures, which might be seen here and here. And they're induced essentially by initial perturbations. And there are the small scale structures, which are essentially irregular, even though it's hard to tell how turbulent the structures are. Now, if we will be talking about how to quantify this type of dynamics reliably, we will see that in principle, there are a lot of challenges. Especially this challenge is significant when we are talking about the extreme parameter regime characterized by strong shocks, quantum redundancies, and large scale perturbations. Only limited information is available about RMI evolution under these conditions. First of all, experiments are rare because the flow implementation, diagnostics, control are very challenging. Eulerian simulations are also a challenge because on the one hand side, they should capture shocks, they should track interfaces, and on the other hand side, they should also account for very accurately dissipation processes. But most importantly, if we will be talking about this, I would say, technological challenge, there is a very specific challenge which is coming with the Richtmeier-Mishkov type of nature flow, because if we will be looking at the instability evolution from a linear regime after the shock passes the interface up to the interfacial mixing regime, what we would know, and what we know already, that this evolution is characterized by several power law dependencies. Say we have a linear growth with time. In the linear regime, there is some weakly nonlinear regime, then there is a decay for the velocity in the interfacial, in the nonlinear regime, and then there is an interfacial mixing. And because at each of these substages, the dynamics is essentially power law, substantial dynamic range and high precision and accuracy of the observation are required to quantify this power law accurately. And usually this information is really hard to obtain in experiments and in the simulations, including those simulations that are conducted at the high class power supercomputers. So what we did, we conducted a systematic study of strong shock driven Richtmeier-Mishkov instability. Our methods included rigorous theoretical analysis. We developed also an empirical model because there might be the situation when the rigorous theoretical analysis are limited in their power. And we applied Lagrange simulations as PHC for Mach number from 1 to essentially 2-6. We achieved good agreement between the simulations and the Syrian experiments in our verification and validation studies, and we identified new properties of the evolution. So I will discuss briefly the methods of study, so this includes theoretical analysis, diagnostics and benchmarks, as well as the simulations and parameter regimes. So for the theoretical analysis, which is common for all these actually methods of analysis, is that they usually do not apply adjustable parameters, and they provide sufficient number of benchmarks to compare with the experiments and simulations. One of them is a zero-order theory, which developed originally by Richtmeier. However, we always refer in our simulations to the work of Nishihara and Vovchuk. They provide us with powerful formulas in the whatever extreme parameter regimes we need to obtain. And this zero-order theory describes the interaction of a planar shock with a planar interface and derives the characteristics of the post-shock background motion of the fluids. Linear theory describes the interaction of a planar shock with a slightly perturbed interface, and when I mean slightly perturbed, it means that the ratio of the amplitude to wavelength cannot exceed within, essentially, it stays within 1% or so, because it should be very, very small initial perturbation. And linear theory derives the linear growth rate of RMI in the broad range of the Mach and Atwood numbers. And we are referring, usually we compare it with the theory of Nishihara and Vovchuk, and Vovchuk 2001. And this is a review paper by these authors. We compare also with the weakly nonlinear models, and there are all sorts of weakly nonlinear models that try to account for, because measuring RMI growth rate when the initial perturbation is 1%, it's a very challenging task, so people usually try to make it a little bit larger, but when they make it a little bit larger, the amplitude start to influence the growth rate, and the question is what the influence is. So far, there was a more formal approach developed by Velikovich, with which we conducted a comparison, and there were also a number of empirical models that were developed by Schwartz and colleagues, Butler et al. More recently, et cetera. In order for us to study nonlinear dynamics, we proceed to the group theory analysis. It was developed by me and colleagues, and we analyzed highly nonlinear dynamics of Richtmeier-Mishkov instability, and also describe the order and disorder in Richtmeier-Mishkov flows. On the top of this, we actually developed another model to describe the simulation data with a statistical confidence. The data and diagnostic benchmarks include the vector and scalar field in the bulk and at the interface, such as amplitude growth, growth rate, and interface morphology. From the zero order, we derive the control parameter and we compare it with very cautiously for the planar interface velocity, and we achieve agreement of our simulations within 1% accuracy. For the linear theory, we conduct special high-resolution runs to evaluate the value of the growth rate, an agreement which is achieved with within 4 to 5% accuracy with the linear theory of the simulations. We achieve reasonable agreement, very similar to what is an experiment with the weakly nonlinear models, And for the group theory, we reproduce very well the flow fields and the morphology of the interface. And the novel empirical model, it actually identifies, it excellently agrees with the available data. So the smooth particle hydrodynamic simulation that we apply is a Lagrangian mesh-free numerical method that allows for a relatively easy treatment of the PDEs governing the fluid motion. So in a sense, it's not a pure particle method, it's not a continuous method, so this is a method that is in between, because it essentially partitions the flow fields and reproduces the motion of the fluid as a motion of the particles. The method applies the particle and kernel approximation to reduce the PDEs to a set of ordinary differential equations, which makes the sense much easier to integrate. The method is in principle suitable for high-performance simulations and is diverse, proven, and robust. This is an outline of the SPH principle on which I will not be going in much details. In fact, actually, the idea here is that in a particle approximation, any function can be represented within this equation. Replacing delta function with a certain kernel operator, we may apply this kernel approximation to describe the functions like this, and then calculate the derivatives using this expression, and in this way reduce the PDEs governing the fluid motion to the ordinary differential equations. The parameter regime in which we have been working, they were all instruction-driven regimes. It included the Mach number 3, 5, 10, output number from 0.3 to 0.95, which means that the density ratio in our cases was varied from essentially 1 to 3 to 1 to 40. And initial perturbation was varied from a planar interface up to the 100% of the wavelength for the initial amplitude. We made additional runs for the planar interface, for very small amplitude interface, et cetera, and conducted extensive validation and verification studies, including standard shock and knock problems. We compared with experiments and, you know, achieved pretty good agreement. Typical number of particles in the simulations, it was 10 to the power of 5. It should be noted that when it was a 10 to the power of 4, actually agreement with a problem such as a NOH problem, it was still within 10% accuracy, so 10 to the power of 5, it was sufficient number of accuracy, number of particles for us. The parameters of these dynamics, it was essentially ideal monatomic gases with a standard gamma 5 sort, and the parameters, if you look cautiously at these values, like, you know, such as the density of the light and heavy fluid or typical pressures, it would be easy for us to notice that such gases don't exist in reality, and it's essentially a mathematical model, so essentially these are fluids which are rarefied, rather stiff gases. And the reason why we selected this parameter regime is that because we wanted to ensure that there is a high energy density per proton, and it was really a large increase of the energy density per energy before and after the shock passage. At the same time, when we were comparing these experiments, we needed to scale this value several orders of magnitude, and we still were in a reasonable agreement with what we had. So it's an RMI evolution, and many people who sit in this audience probably are well familiar with this picture. And this actually evolution shows us the post-shock dynamics of Richtmeier-Meshkov instability. And we do observe that there is a superposition of the two motions. First of all, after the shock passage from the light heavy fluid to fluid, to heavy fluid in our case, both fluids and interface between them start to move. And they move as a whole unit. So we see this displacement this time. On the other hand, there is an interface growth because of the impulsive acceleration induced by the shock, and we also observe this interface growth, as you may see it from here. If we will look, so there is a background motion, and there is an interfacial growth. If we will look at the span of scales, essentially this kind of estimate tells us what the challenges of this problem are, and why probably the problem cannot be solved for so many years or even decades, maybe essentially like, you know, 60 or 40 years. When the shock goes from the light to heavy, the largest velocity in the fluid system is the shock velocity. If we will be looking at the velocity of this background motion with which both fluids and interface between move after the shock passage, it depends on the Mach number, output number, gammas, on a variety of factors, but to a large extent, it's essentially about 10% of the shock velocity. So we have one order of magnitude down. If you would like to look at the initial growth rate, then the initial growth rate, it also depends on various output number, Mach number, typical gammas, et cetera. But on average, it's about 10% of the background motion of velocity. So from the shock velocity, we need to go two orders of magnitude down. If we will be looking at the nonlinear regime, in order to quantify nonlinear dynamics accurately, we need to also to go about 10% of the initial growth rate, which give us already 10 to the minus 3 of the shock velocity. And if for whatever reasons we would like to proceed to the mixing regime, we need to go one order of magnitude one more, which give us essentially 10 to the minus 4 of the shock velocity. So in a sense, we have a phenomena where we need to go from a scale up to 1 to the scale to minus 4, and we need to track and accurately measure each and every number, which makes the problem really challenging to study. So the background motion develops whenever the shock is planar and interface is planar, so we do not need to have any perturbation for the background motion to occur. Whereas the interfacial growth develops because of impulsive acceleration due to the shock. If the shock is ideal and planar and steady, we need to have a perturbed interface for the instability to start to grow. So our benchmarks, as I mentioned, you know, for these simulations was to look for the zero order linear and highly nonlinear series, as well as the gas dynamic experiments. So magnitude of the background motion velocity. So this picture shows us essentially it's a color with which we color the velocity component in the direction of shock propagation in case when there is a planar interface. And there is an interface between the two fluids, which is somewhere around 10 in this picture. But we see that actually the light fluid, the heavy fluid, and the interface between them, they're essentially invisible because they move with the same velocity. Whereas there is a perturbed interface, we do see that there is a velocity growth on the background of this background motion. And the ratio of typical magnitudes of values of here to the background motion is essentially about 10% or so. Agreement that we achieved for the value of V infinity, and we call it V infinity because it means that we have an infinitely planar interface was within 1% of accuracy. Similarly, we conducted the comparison with the linear growth rate with a series that was developed by Vovchuk, and we conducted separate resolution runs with a very small, less than 1% initial perturbation amplitude, and we achieved very good agreement, 4 to 5%. In principle, this agreement remains reasonable when the amplitude perturbation becomes 6% of the amplitude wavelengths. So if we will be looking for the late time evolution of the flow fields, essentially there are two characteristics because we have a power law dynamics and we essentially don't have a substantial dynamic range to quantify velocity very accurately, we better look at some qualitative features. And one of them is a velocity field, typical velocity field in the frame of reference that moves with the velocity of the background motion. And what essentially this field tells us that while there are very small scale component structures, we don't have essentially zero velocity away from the interface, and we have intense motion in the vicinity of the interface. The other actually important quantitative parameter is the flattening of the bubble front, and we do observe that in majority of our simulations, when we propagate far enough to the nonlinear regime, the Richtmeyer-Vishkov bubbles flatten and decelerates. We would like also to look what would be the, how our data would fit compared to experiments, and we compare with the gas dynamic experiments, which is essentially experimental cases of 5 and 10, 8 given. And these are the experimental data versus numerical simulation data, and we see the agreement is pretty good. So quite often, especially in the funding agencies communities, people say that simulation can be a discovery tool. And I would say that, you know, this is why I place it this since like in a waters, so it's a discovery tool. But in fact, actually, sometime when we, what is really quite important is to formulate the problem cautiously. So in our case, the theory essentially was working very closely with the simulations, and we tried to formulate the problem properly such that our simulations would have actually really good meaning and we may obtain the meaningful results. So one of the things, the key results that we have obtained thus far were that, first of all, we identified to the first time by our knowledge that there is a characteristic amplitude scale that defines the maximum initial growth rate, and we did it very cautiously. We found that there are non-uniform small-scale dynamics at the interface and in the bulk, implying that there is also the scale coupling between the interfacial and bulk dynamics. Plus, we found also that there is a strong effect of wave interference of the initial perturbation waves on the order, disorder, and Richtmeyer-Mishkov flows. So the first thing is about RMI initial growth rate. We call this growth rate initial because essentially we tried to measure it at some initial stages, and we would like to separate between initial growth rate and linear growth rate. When we would be looking at this picture, we see essentially what happens to the amplitude. So first, after the shock passes the interface is first compressed, And after the shock passes the interface perturbations start to grow. So of course, when the amplitude is very small, the linear theory can provide us with certain values, but these values are because the growth rate is proportional to the amplitude. When the amplitude is small, the growth rate is small. It means that it's really hard to measure. So we try to make it larger, but then various effects should start to play a role, and it's hard to say what the result will be. So what we did, we conducted this systematically in a broad range of the Mach and Atwood numbers, and we measured the initial growth rate at the very initial moment of time. And this time scale was essentially defined not by the V0, not by the value of the initial growth rate, but rather by the typical time scale, which is set by the background motion velocity, because this time scale is really a robust parameter. It can, it has a clear physics meaning, and it can be easy controlled in experiments. So we don't put additional error bars into the scaling. This is what linear theory predicts, how the amplitude should depend, how the initial growth rate should depend on the amplitude. And it's natural that it's a linear growth, and linear theory works only when the initial perturbation amplitude is very small. There were a number of weakling and linear analysis that tried to calculate the correction factor to this linear theory. One of them, it was the theory of Vilipovich, and it also predicts that there would be some growth of the initial growth rate with the initial amplitude. And while this growth would be smaller than linear when the amplitude is pretty large, it still would be some monotone function of the initial amplitude. This is the case, I believe it's a Mach 3 Atwood 0.6, and what we see is that, in fact, actually, initially, we, in a good agreement with the linear theory as well as with linear analysis, we have a growth of the initial growth rate with an initial amplitude. However, when the sum maximum value is achieved, our numerical simulation results show that there is a non-monotone dependence of the initial growth rate, and there is a decay of the initial perturbation of the initial growth. We repeated this exercise for the bunch of the Mach and Atwood number, and what we have noticed is that there is indeed the non-monotone dependence of the initial growth rate with an initial amplitude. And there are some interesting features here, because while the maximum value of the initial growth rate does depend on the Mach and Atwood number, at least for ideal fluids, the position of the characteristic amplitude scale at which this maximum growth rate is achieved is insensitive, is relatively insensitive to the characteristic Mach and Atwood number. Furthermore, if we will be measuring, for instance, the position of the middle line velocity, which is easily to obtain in experiments, we also see that the position of the maxima, which we are here, they're very correlated with the position of the minimum for the middle line velocity. It means that we don't have essentially a numerical artifact. And if we will be comparing our maxima and minimum value, we see that there is a really good correlation for the maximum of the initial growth rate with the minimum value of the initial of the middle line velocity, even though the middle line itself does not have it's not a kind of really special, it's just a convenient line for a position to measure. Now we try to scale, to play with data a little bit more, and we scale this dependence, which is the ratio of the initial growth rate to the background velocity, and this parameter essentially has a physics meaning of a fraction of energy that is available for interfacial mixing, and its value is pretty small. And we see that if we have a scale it with an Atwood number, we see essentially quite good universal behavior, so dependence of the initial of this parameter with the characteristic amplitude. Usually, I'm very against empirical models because I do prefer to develop rigorous theories, but there might be the situation when we do need an empirical model, at least try to understand what our data are. Because we might develop a good theory in this regime, we might develop a good theory at a very, very long time, but when we have an initial time and finite amplitude, we do need to understand what our data tells us, actually, what is the situation. Because in this case, we have a characteristic amplitude scale, we try to fit our data with the following dependences, which account for the two cases. First of all, we have a linear, when the amplitude is very small, we have a linear growth according to the linear theory. Second, when the amplitude becomes very large, we have a decay, and this is decaying function, and we apply an exponent rather than any other power law or a rational function, because we see in the simulations that there is a characteristic amplitude scale. So the parameters C1 and C2 are free adjustable parameters, and we try to identify this parameter's value from our data sets. Essentially, we consider over 20 curves. We do it curve-wise, then we do it through the data points, considering the entire data set. through the 300 data points and as well as about 20,000 pairs of data points. So it's a really well-designed statistics. And if you have this dependence for the model, we can easily transform it into the linear fit, which is essentially presented here. And for the value z versus x, which is an initial amplitude, according to this expression, we should have a linear dependence, and we do observe the good collapse of data along this curve. So essentially, we see that when our amplitude is large enough, roughly speaking, greater than 0.1 and up, we do have a very nice exponential decay. This picture shows us our result. It's a ratio between the initial growth rate and linear growth rate, as well as the experimental data points. Linear growth rate, actually the difference in the intercept appears because the linear growth rate is not really accurate. It's really a challenge to identify accurately in experiments and simulations. However, the thing which we are looking here is essentially the slope of this line. And the slope of this line in our model and the simulations, as well as in experimental data, including like experimental data of Alyoshin, I would say 1990-something, they agree up to the third significant digit. So this is, as soon as we know these parameter values for our C1 and C2, what we see that in our data set is defined very accurately within few percent of accuracy, essentially 6% here and 7% here. As soon as we have our expression for the initial growth rate, we can evaluate the maximum value of the growth rate, the characteristic amplitude scale, as well as the maximum fraction of energy available for interfacial mixing. And I would like to point your attention that this would be true for any Mach and Atwood number. And even though we consider that essentially only ideal gases with a gamma equal to 5 sort, we believe that the sensitivity of these results to the gamma would not be very large. Because in fact, in this expression, there is no any gamma dependence. And this is one more time. Like, you know, these are experimental data coming from, these are data from our results, our model. This is experimental data by Alyoshin. And these are experiments of which have been taken, essentially referring to the experiments of DeMonti and Remington, where they evaluated Mach number as a large or Mach number as a greater than 20. Various models, such as the model of Schwartz and I think also Glendening model, they tried to play with this data and to provide, you know, some evaluations. This is why we have such a significant scatter, evaluating Mach number as a 15 or 15.3. But what we see here is that essentially this decay should be defined by the initial amplitude only and should not be independent of the Mach and Atwood number, of course. So it's like, you know, another comparison. In fact, the question is why this characteristic universal scale appears, because what does it say us? It says that, okay, we make our initial amplitude larger, we have more energy put into the interface. We make initial amplitude even bigger, then there is even more energy sitting at the interface. Now we make it infinitely large, and we see that essentially there is no any growth rate of the instability. It's in a sense it's natural because there is a strong dependence of the on the vorticity left by the shock, and when the amplitude becomes very large, then the vorticity effect essentially will be zero. On the one hand, when the amplitude is very large, we have just a smooth transition from one fluid to another fluid, and no instability might occur. What is quite important is that there is indeed a characteristic scale because we do observe the exponential dependence rather than a power law or a rational function of the initial perturbation amplitude. So the question is, when we start to increase the amplitude, what happens to the energy? Because we are trying to put more energy to the interface, and instead we have a larger growth rate, we have a growth rate decay. Well, it appears that, in fact, the large perturbation amplitude influences not only the dynamics at the interface, but also dynamics in the bulk. Specifically, if you will compare, for instance, the position of the transmitted shock here in case of planar interface and in case of perturbed interface, we see that when the amplitude becomes very large, the shock start to propagate, transmitted shock start to propagate quicker. And in principle, this means that this type of dynamics can be used also as an additional diagnostics for the flow. We observe a lot of small-scale structures in our simulations at the interface, which is kind of natural thing for us to observe, such as development of the Kellen-Gilgold instability. But we observe also some other structures, which are small-scale structures in the bulk. And I kindly point your attention, for instance, to this picture, which shows a typical temperature field. What we have here, we have observation of cumulative jets. We call them reverse jets because they propagate to the direction reverse to the propagation of the spike. And their appearance, they appear because, like, you know, two flows collide at a small angle of attack. It's a standard cumulative jet. It's very energetic, it's short-living, but it creates hot spots inside the bulk, whose temperature can be essentially like, you know, twofold of that of the ambient, which is kind of a case here. And definitely similar structures are observed also in experiments, which might be kind of demonstrated here and here. Now, one more thing to which I probably will tell really just in passing, it would be a question how the order and disorder in Riemann-Meerschaum flows might appear. And traditionally, we do know that initial conditions in fluid dynamics of RMI. Currently, research is focused primarily on the effect of the wavelengths and amplitude of the interface perturbation, even though what we have found has not been discussed before, such as exponential decay of the initial growth rate with an initial amplitude. But what we would like to do also, we would like to study the co-influence of effects of the relative phase and the amplitude of the perturbation waves on the large-scale structure of the bubbles and spikes in Riemann-Meerschaum theory and Riemann-Meerschaum flow, and we apply the group theory analysis, keeping going. So what we have found that, in fact, the phase of waves and the interference of waves constituting the initial perturbation have a dramatic effect on the order and disorder in Riemann-Meerschaum flow. I will be skipping probably the group theory considerations, just would like to show you two nice pictures. So what is this? It's a flow evolution in one case and the flow evolution in the other case at certain moments of time. Output number is the same, Mach number is the same, it was 5. The moments of time at which the snapshots have been taken are given here. There are two waves. They have, in both cases, the amplitude of the waves is the same and the wavelengths of the waves are the same. The only difference that in this case, the waves are anti-phase, meaning that the relative phase between these waves is pi, whereas in this case, the relative phase between these waves is pi over 2. And if I would like to present it like here, so essentially we have two waves and different phase is presented by this parameter. So what we see here is that this silent parameter that present in every, essentially, initial conditions, in every experiments and simulations, appears to be to play a very definitive role, because if we have an anti-phase configuration, we have a well-designed order at the quite nonlinear stages of the instability, whereas when the phase is random, such as a pi over 2, we have appearance of disorder. People might call it turbulent. I would still call it chaotic, or maybe not, rather than stochastic, because in this case, we do know that there is a parameter such as the relative phase of waves, which we may control, and which we may vary, like, you know, creating typical order or a disorder. What is the one? Yeah, I'm almost done. So in fact, actually, this parameter plays important role, not only quantitatively, creating order or disorder, but it also start to influence the growth rate of the instability. For instance, when we have the same ratio of the first and second harmonics here, we may vary the initial growth rate substantially, essentially twofold when the amplitude is pretty large, and when the phase is, say, in phase, anti-phase, and random phase. And these lines which are given here, they're just given for a convenience. They're not functions, they're just lines. And I'm concluding. Okay. Yeah. So the conclusion would be such that we performed it's not the first actually, but we conducted the systematic study of the Riemann-Meerschaum instability induced by strong shocks. We applied the theory and the simulations, and we collaborated really strongly together, trying to obtain some new results. So what we found that the velocity of the background motion, it's a kind of polychinelle secret in our view in Riemann-Meerschaum community, because everyone knows that it exists, everyone observes it. However, people really hardly measure and monitor it. What we say is that this parameter is important, it's robust, it's reliable, and it should be applied not only to quantify the flow, but it also should be applied for the scaling. We found also that a significant part of the shock energy goes into compression and background motion of the fluids. Only a small fraction of the shock energy remains for interfacial mixing. There is a strong dependence of this shock energy, interfacial shock energy on the interface perturbations. When the amplitude of this interface perturbation is very small, the growth rate grows linearly with time. However, when the amplitude becomes larger, there is a non-monotone dependence of the initial growth rate. There is a characteristic length scale, which appears to be a universal quantity of RMI dynamics at which this growth rate is achieved and which is not dependent on the Mach and output number. And as a result, we can calculate a lot of useful values, such as the maximum initial growth rate, maximum fraction of energy available of interfacial mixing, et cetera. And the decay of the growth rate with the initial amplitude is exponential rather than a power law. So at late time, bubbles flatten decelerates, and the fluid interface can always keep some order, whereas the dynamics in the bulk at small scales is non-uniform and heterogeneous. And I think that would be it. Yeah.